settle in and prepare our hearts to worship the Lord together. It's good to be here, restrictions and all. We look forward to being able to worship together. We're kind of privileged to be able to approach and to draw near to our great God. And as we do that, just want to give us a little bit of time up front to prepare our hearts, and then I'll read a call to worship from Psalm 33, and then I invite you to stand and we'll sing together. So let's prepare our hearts to worship. Now as you stand and hear this word from Psalm 33, this is what God's word says. It says, "Shout for joy in the Lord, O you righteous. Praise befits the upright. Give thanks to the Lord with the lyre. Make melody to him with the harp of 10 strings. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully on the strings with loud shouts. For the word of the Lord is upright. And all his work is done in faithfulness. He loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the steadfast love of the Lord. Our souls wait for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. For our heart is glad in him, because we trust in his holy name. Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope." Our care for us. You care for your creation in just a general way. We're told that you're good to all that you have made, and yet you have a special care for your children. You love us with this deep, inexpressible love, and you demonstrated that love towards us in sending Jesus to save us, and giving us everything that we need for life and godliness. You are a good Father. Jesus spoke and talked about how, like, even earthly fathers being wicked know how to give good things. How much more will our Father in heaven give to us good things? And in that text, he was talking specifically about the Holy Spirit. So even the presence of the Spirit in our lives is a reminder of your goodness to us as a Father. And so, Lord, help us to not take that lightly. Like, the world around us is not just sort of moving along, and people are not just sort of doing whatever it is that they please. Ultimately, this is your world, and as the verse says, though the wrong seems off so strong, you are still the ruler. You are still in control and in charge. And so help us to remember that's true about this world, and that's true about our own lives. There are times when even our own lives seem a bit out of control, or the wrong in our own lives seems so strong. And help us to remember that you are our Father, and you are the ruler of all things. And help us to look forward to that day, and to bear in mind that Jesus who died will be satisfied, and earth and heaven will be one. Jesus will have the reward of his suffering. I was watching a little documentary just the other day where people just kind of spoke, or at least one guy in particular spoke about Jesus, and like just deriding Jesus as just some Hebrew man who died a long time ago. But you are the one who died and rose again, who defeated the grave, and all those who trust in you, because of your resurrection, can walk in newness of life and can have the hope of life eternal. So you, surely as you lived and died and rose again, you will come again to gather all your people to yourself. And this great and glorious promise that we see running through the scripture, where there will be a new heaven and a new earth, that day is coming, and that day will be realized when you return. And so help us to hope in that, and not and realize that it's not an empty hope, but it's one that that can sustain us through the worst that this life has to offer. So encourage our hearts, Lord, that as we gather this morning to worship you, the God who owns everything, who loves us dearly, and who sent his Son to save us. Yeah, so help us to honor you in our time together. We ask in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
do. You need to take a seat, though. Feel free to do that. We're going to read together from Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19 to 25. Focus our attention particularly on verses 23 to 25, but just to give you a bit of the context, we'll read from verse 19. Again, that's Hebrews 10, starting at verse 19, and we'll read to verse 25. This is what God's word says. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the holy places by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. This is God's word. You can have a seat. So we're going to take a quick break from studying 1 Corinthians, which is where we've been for the last little while now. We're going to put the discussion about spiritual gifts on pause for a second. And start in a couple of weeks, in the month of October, we're actually going to take the entire month to celebrate our 60th anniversary as a church, which is something that we want to praise God for. Amen. It's incredible to think that the ministry of this church has been going for 60 years. It started before any of us got here, but by the grace of God, we are all now a part of the legacy of what God is doing, a legacy of God's faithfulness, and the advance of the gospel right here in Rexdale. Even though this community has changed, like this was all, back in 1960, this was all farmland, and even though a lot of the members of this church have changed. The word says that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And because Jesus is the same, like our mission is the same. We want to know Jesus and grow to be more and more like him, and we want to make him known. And so, I would just encourage you, I think it would be great if a bunch of us just prayed and asked that the Lord would honor himself on next month as we celebrate 60 years of his faithfulness to us as a church, as we look back and at the same time as we look forward in anticipation of what he'll do in years to come. So that's what's coming up in October. But until then, for the next 2 weeks, we're going to take some time just to think about our vision as a church. I think it's good for us to do that every so often. I'm actually thinking about building that into the regular diet of our preaching as a church. So every year in the fall, as we start to get ready to start up ministries again and things get rolling again after a break from the summer, even though this year has been really weird, we want to take time and do a little vision check. Like you might get your yearly, or I think you do it every 2 years, get your eyes examined just to make sure that you're seeing everything clearly and that everything is okay. We want to make sure that what we're trying to accomplish as a church is clear and in focus so that we can really work towards what it is that God would have us accomplish in the strength that he supplies. And so I want to take a couple weeks to do that, just to think about our vision as a church. What is it that we're trying to accomplish? And just in case you were wondering, it goes something like this. Like as a church, Thistletown Baptist Church, we're building a community of people who are becoming like Christ by his grace for his glory. And so we just want to take the next couple of weeks to think about those things. Think about building a community and think about becoming like Jesus. How is it that we hope to accomplish that as a church, especially in light of the challenges that we now face because of COVID-19. Like, everybody's having to learn how to deal with this thing, right? And we have to learn how to deal with that as Christians. So how do we stay focused and keep moving towards this vision in the midst of a pandemic? Like, how do we have pandemic-proof community? Like, I've been hearing a lot of talk about how businesses can make what they do pandemic-proof. Like, what are some things that we can do as a business to make sure that we survive through COVID-19? And as Christians, we want to think about what are some of the things that we can do to ensure that we continue to stay connected as a community, continue to work at building one another up as a community, and continue to grow as a community to be people who look and live a lot like Jesus. How can we thrive through COVID-19? And so this sermon is simply called this morning, Pandemic-Proof Community. And as I said, I just want to focus. We read Hebrews 10, verse 19 to 25, but I'm just going to camp out, or we'll camp out together on verses 23 to 25. And this is the main point of the sermon. And we're sort of picking up in the middle of a argument or a point that the writer to the Hebrews is making. And essentially what he says is that because we have access to God through Jesus, we should hold on to the faith and hold on to fellowship. Or to put it another way, like, because we have access to God through Jesus, because of what we have in Jesus, like, we have what it takes to cope with COVID-19 or anything else that this world would throw at us. And we do that together as a community. And so, as I said, these verses come right in the middle of a point that the writer to the Hebrews is making about what believers have in Jesus. And just to give you a quick synopsis, what he says is that in Jesus we have a perfect high priest. And in Jesus we have a perfect mediator. And in Jesus we have the perfect sacrifice. And there's tons of stuff that we can camp out on each one of those things and spend days just thinking about what that means and the implications of that for us as believers. But let me just say this. Like, because of who Jesus is and what he has done, like, as believers, we have access to God. And because we have access to God, which is no small thing, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 22 tells us this. It says, let us draw near with a true heart and full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. In other words, like, because of what Jesus has done, because of who Jesus is for us as his people, like, we can come confidently to God in praise and prayer. And we can do that even in the midst of a pandemic. But what I want to show you, the two things that I want to particularly camp out on are found in verses 23 to 25. And there are two things that are absolutely important for us if we're going to maintain a pandemic-proof community where people continue to grow and become more like Jesus. Those two things are as follows. If we're going to do that, number one, we got to hold on to the faith. And number two, we got to hold on to fellowship. Hold on to the faith and hold on to fellowship. So let's talk about it from the text. Notice in verse 23, we get this encouragement to hold on to the faith. It says, let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful. If we're going to continue to build community with one another and we're going to continue to stay connected as a body, we need to hold on to the faith. We need to hold on to the very thing that holds us together as a community. You see, what holds us together as a church is the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's the truth that Jesus died for our sins and was raised. And because Jesus was raised, because Jesus is alive even now, all those who repent and place their faith in him, we too can walk in newness of life. Like, that's our hope for being able to walk and to live lives that are pleasing to God. But it's not like, okay, we believe the gospel, that's sort of how we start out, like we put our faith in Christ alone, and then that's it. No, like it's one thing to start the Christian life well, but you gotta finish. Like it's not like when, say for example, I tell Ezra and Benaiah like they need to clean up their room or whatever mess it is that they just made, which happens all day long, every day. As long as I'm there and I tell them, hey, pick this up, clean that up, like they start off really well. But the minute I walk away, like if I were to walk away and then to come back, like 9 times out of 10, like they haven't finished what they started. Sometimes they do okay, like they surprise me and they've actually cleaned up the whole place. But usually that's not how it goes. I have to tell them, no, like you're not done. Keep going. You gotta keep going. And that's how the Christian life works. It's not just about starting well. Okay, yeah, I believe in Jesus. My faith is in him. Like, it's about persevering to the end. You don't want to have the kind of faith like Jesus describes when he tells the parable of the sower. When he talks about that seed that falls on rocky ground. Like, that springs up for a little bit, but then it doesn't last. Like, you don't want to be a person who quote-unquote believes the gospel and you're excited about it for a season and you endure for a little bit, but then you just fall away. No, saving faith is a faith that perseveres. It holds on to the gospel from start to finish. That's why the New Testament is full of encouragement to believers to persevere in the faith, to keep believing the gospel. And that's something that we do, that you have to do that as an individual. Like, nobody can believe in Jesus for you. Nobody can trust in Jesus for you. But it's also true that we need other believers to help us continue trusting in Jesus, to encourage us to keep believing in him. Listen to the community language. Don't miss that in verse 23. It doesn't say you need to hold fast the confession of your hope. It says, let us hold fast the confession of our hope. Faith in Jesus is what saves us. It's what holds us together as a people, and it's what we've been called to hold on together. Or hold on to, like, together. Like, together we are to confess that Jesus is our only hope. Yep, so there's an individual component to it, obviously, but you're not meant to do it alone. We have to hang on to the confession of our hope without wavering, the text says. So imagine, I don't know if you've ever seen these people that go water skiing. So you strap on some skis and you grab onto a handle that's attached to a rope that's attached to the back of a boat. You gotta hang on to that handle while that boat pulls you across the water like at crazy speeds. Like that to me, just that by itself seems incredibly difficult to do. I don't know why. Like, I guess some people find that sort of thing fun. Maybe it is fun, but it just looks difficult to me. But imagine if on top of that, if you weren't just expected to like hang on to that handle that's attached to the rope, that's attached to the back of the boat while it's going really fast. Imagine doing that in the middle of a hurricane. So you now not only have to try to hang on to that handle and stay on your feet, but you have to try to do that without wavering. Like while these hurricane force winds are just blowing every which way, you have to try to hold on to that thing and keep from bending one way or another. But there's a sense in which, like, that's exactly what the Christian life is like. When Paul uses this language, not Paul, when the writer to the Hebrews uses this language of hanging on, holding fast to the faith without wavering. That's sort of the picture. And I don't know about you, but when I first hear this command, this exhortation to hold fast to the faith without wavering, if you just read that on its own, and if I'm thinking like it rests on me to get that done, I don't find that encouraging. Like, to me, that just seems impossible. I just think to myself, I can't do that. If it depends on me to make sure that happens, then like I don't stand a chance. Like, if our holding on to the faith just rests on us and in our strength, we're just like a person trying to water ski in the middle of a hurricane. We're not going to make it. But brothers and sisters, notice what the basis for our being able to hold fast to the faith is. The basis of our being able to hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering comes at the end of the verse. For he who promised is faithful. It rests in the faithfulness of God. We can hold on to the faith because God is faithful. Because Psalm 117 verse 2 reminds us that the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. So like I said last week Sunday, you probably don't remember, but last week Sunday I talked about how we don't want to be a church that, like, whenever things start to get difficult, like, the first thing we think is, okay, we gotta dig deep and we gotta work hard. No, we don't want to do that. What we want to do instead is let the difficulties that we encounter drive us to a deeper dependence on the Lord. And then from a place of deep dependence on the Lord, then we go to work doing what it is that he's called us to do. Like making disciples, loving and serving one another in the strength that he supplies. But where we need to start is by reminding ourselves of the faithfulness of the Lord. Reminding ourselves that we belong to a God who is absolutely, totally, perfectly trustworthy. He can be relied on. If he says he's going to do something, he'll do it. He who promised is faithful. But what has he promised us? What has God promised us as his people? We could spend all day just working through that. Like, you know your Bible as well, you know the promises of God, but we could spend like days thinking about that. There's a sense in which, like 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20 says, for all the promises of God find their yes in him, in Jesus. In other words, all of the promises of Scripture are pointing and moving towards Jesus and what God would accomplish for his people through Jesus. And so you take a promise like Isaiah 41, verse 10. Isaiah 41, verse 10 says, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. Now, that's a promise that's made to the people of Israel. But as I said, all of the promises of God are yes. They find their yes and amen in Jesus. They're all moving and working towards him. And so because of Jesus and what he's accomplished for us, like, this is true of us. Like, because of Jesus, God is with us. Because of Jesus, we don't have to be afraid. Because of Jesus, God will help us. He will sustain us. And notice how in this promise, there's no exception clause there. God doesn't say, okay, don't be scared. I'm with you. I got you. I'll help you. I'll strengthen you. I'll sustain you unless this happens. And then you're on your own. He doesn't say, I'll do all of these things unless there happens to be a global pandemic and then I can't help it. No, like, even if there's all this talk about second waves and all that kind of stuff, there could be a second, third, fourth, fifth wave. And he's still going to be with us to help us. He's going to be with us to sustain us and to strengthen us. Like, it doesn't matter, regardless of what's going on politically here or south of the border, it does not matter. Like, even if the earth be removed and the mountains be thrown into the heart of the sea, even then, this is He's a very present help in trouble. And he's faithful. We can trust him. And so, brothers and sisters, we need to keep learning how to trust the Lord and trust his faithfulness. We need to keep learning how to believe that when God says, like, be still and know that I am God and I will be exalted among the nations, he means that. We need to rest in that. Like, that's his call to us when we're tempted to look around and be afraid and worried about everything that's going on around us or whatever it is that's going on in our lives. We're called to be still and know that he is God, that he will be exalted among the nations, that he will accomplish his plans and purposes for his people, including you. And so we need to trust him, and we hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, because he who promised is faithful. But once again, notice that's not something that we just do as individuals. No, that's not how God designed it to work. A huge part of us holding on to the faith involves us holding on to fellowship. We hold on to the faith together. And so in verses 24 and 25, that's the encouragement that we get. We hold on to the faith that holds us together. We hold on to the gospel, and we got to hold on to fellowship. Like that's important if we're going to maintain community, continue to build community, thrive together as God's people. Listen to verse 24. It says, and let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works. And in short, we need to encourage one another. Like, everybody needs to be encouraged sometime. Like, that's just true of human beings in general, but particularly as Christians, it's not just that we need to be encouraged, but we also need to be encouraging other people. Like, is that how you see yourself? Do you recognize that about yourself? Those two things. I need to be encouraged. I need to have other Christians around me who can remind me of what Jesus has done, who can encourage me to persevere in the faith. But I also need to be that for somebody else. I need to come alongside another brother or sister and be someone who is an encouragement to them. Everybody needs an encouragement. You see, because there's a real temptation, I think, if we're honest, that can affect most, if not all of us. And that's this temptation to want to drift towards isolation. Some of us are more prone to that sort of thing than others. But there's this tendency that can pop up in the Christian life for us to drift towards isolation and just sort of think, okay, I can do this thing on my own. And some people do it for, like, I've run across so many people who, like they walk and live as a believer in isolation because they're like, oh, I don't want to be a burden to my other brothers and sisters in Christ. I don't want to burden you with this or that. When the truth of the matter is, like, that's why we're together. Like, that's part of the reason that God has put us together, that we can bear one another's burdens. But for different reasons, some of us are prone towards, like, drifting towards isolation and just trying to do the Christian life on our own. Like, nobody really knows what's going on with us. Nobody really is coming alongside us and trying to help us. And even if they wanted to, like, they wouldn't, like, some people are like, it's like a fortress. Like, they just won't let you in. And even if you're not the type of person who's like that, like, you recognize how much you need other brothers and sisters in Christ around you. The fact of the matter is, for the last 6 months, like, all of us have had to keep people at a distance, whether we wanted to or not. Like, all of our sort of normal interactions with people have been disrupted because of this ongoing, like, this thing that doesn't seem to want to go away. And so how do we fight against that temptation to drift towards isolation? And what do we do with, like, this isolation that sometimes happens to us, just, like, that's outside of our control? Well, I just want to say this much. Like, for people that are prone towards, like, drifting towards isolation on their own, like, you don't drift towards holiness and Christ-likeness. Like, that doesn't just happen. You don't just wake up one morning and, like, all of a sudden you're more holy. Oh, I'm more like Jesus. That doesn't happen for people who drift. If anything, the Word tells us that the way our hearts are prone when we begin to drift is we drift towards sin. And so you think about a verse like Hebrews 3, verse 13. It tells us that we are to exhort one another every day, as long as it's called today, so that there would be in none of us an evil and unbelieving heart leading us to fall away from the living God. That none of us would be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. Like, that's what happens to people who drift. And so we need one another around. Like, we need to be around each other. We need other people around us in order to encourage one another daily. See, as believers, like, all of us are up against this triple threat of the world, the flesh, and the devil. And so you got the world, this system of beliefs, and this way of life that is no friend of God or his people. And then on top of that, like, each of us have our own sinful temptations and tendencies that we have to fight against. Peter tells the believers that he writes to in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11. He says, "Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh which wage war against your souls." So we're fighting against our own sinfulness and our own temptations. And on top of all of that, like, we have a very real spiritual enemy in the devil. 1 Peter 5, the devil prowls around like a roaring lion looking for somebody to devour. And we're told in 1 Peter 5 that we ought to resist him. We ought to be on guard, be watchful against him. And there is no way that we can do all of those things on our own. It won't happen. Like, up against that triple threat of the world, the flesh, and the devil, like, you will get eaten alive on your own. We need other brothers and sisters around us to help us. We need encouragement. We need to receive encouragement, and we need to be people who give encouragement as well. And when you think about that, like, is that how you see yourself as a Christian? Like, as somebody who needs encouragement and somebody who needs to give encouragement. And not just generally, like, that's how I see myself, but do you think about specific people in this congregation that you could be an encouragement to? Like, do you think about specific people that you could stir up to love and good deeds? Like, how can I do that for Juliet and Sherman? Or how can I stir up Pedro and Odette to love and good deeds? How can I stir up Zoe to love and good deeds? Do you think about actual people that you go to church with week after week? That's what we're called to do, to stir one another up to love and good deeds. And for some of us, that's going to mean that we have to start by just resisting this temptation to have our world become really small. And again, like, whether we wanted it to or not, like, that's happened to some degree to all of us. Like, our social circles have literally gotten smaller just because of all of the different, like, the ever-changing rules and regulations around this pandemic. And so we've got to find ways in the midst of that to be encouraged and to be encouraging other people. And it starts, like, it could seem kind of overwhelming, like, when you start to look at a text like this, like, man, you read that and it just feels like one more thing I have to do. Like, anybody else feel tired, like, what are they calling it, COVID fatigue or whatever? Anybody else who just feel, for whatever reason, you would think, like, I'm spending a lot of time at home and, like, my normal, for a little while it kind of felt like a vacation, but now I just feel tired all the time, and I'm not really sure why. And then you see a verse like this, like, consider how to stir up one another to love and good deeds, and it just seems like one more thing I gotta do. So now, on top of all this other fatigue that I feel, I gotta find the time and the energy to encourage somebody else. But this is not a burden. Like, it's actually an opportunity for us to bear each other's burdens, if we're thinking about it right. And so, like, the way that I would encourage you is, like, don't like, bite off more than you can chew, if I can put it like that. This doesn't have to be, like, you can take baby steps. Like, you don't have to call every single person in the church directly. Like, just think of one person. I rattled off, like, five or six people. Think of one person. How can I intentionally, like, stir this person up, encourage this person towards love and good deeds? Like, that's what, like, there's nothing wrong with baby steps. Like, sometimes we put acts of faith or whatever, or obedience in different categories. And so we got, like, we want to be Peter, like, when he stepped out of the boat and walked on water. But, like, we don't really care too much to be Peter, who's just sort of following Jesus around, making mistakes and learning things as he goes. Like, that's not exciting to us. But don't underestimate the importance of just ordinary obedience. So it doesn't have to be this big thing. Like, find one person that you can be an encouragement to. And give them a call. And if you're anything like me, I do not like talking on the phone. The Lord, in his sense of humor, like, gave me a calling that involved, like, a lot of phone calls as a pastor. And so that's just part of the way that he stretches me and helps me to grow. But if you're like me and you don't like to make phone calls, like, send somebody a text message. It's a start. Like, find ways that you can sort of remain connected with people, even in all of the difficulties that we presently face. And the goal in us, notice in verse 24, the goal is to stir one another up to love and good deeds. We want to encourage each other in the faith. But let's be honest, sometimes, like, people just need to know that somebody else is thinking about. Sometimes people just need to know that somebody else cares. They cared enough to pick up the phone and call me. Like, you don't have to, like, I can, again, maybe I'm the only one who has this issue, but sometimes I can psych myself out and think, like, man, I need to have something really profound to say before I pick up the phone. Like, I need to have something that's just going to lift them through the roof spiritually. But no, like, sometimes just the thought, like, man, this person thought about me. I had somebody the other day, like, tell me after, a couple days after, like, hey, wasn't your birthday a couple of days ago? And I was like, yeah, it's my 40th birthday or whatever. And then there's like, oh, you know, I missed your birthday. We'll have to fix that. And I'm thinking, like, just the fact that you remember, even if it was a couple of days late, I'm like, I appreciate that. And so our aim is to encourage each other in the faith, but sometimes, like, people just need to know that somebody cared enough to pick up the phone. Check on it and see how it's doing. Like, don't underestimate the importance and the power of that kind of thing to actually help to strengthen connections that will help us to build community, even with all of the difficulties that we face. But here's where this verse gets kind of tricky, though, or where this whole section, where it gets tricky. Given all the restrictions and the rules that we now have in place, because of this reality that we know as COVID-19. It gets particularly difficult in verse 25. So we've been talking about encouraging one another and how important that is. If we're gonna hold on to the faith, we need one another. We need to be encouraging one another. And one of the most important ways that we encourage one another is by actually getting together with one another. So it says, let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good deeds. Then verse 25 says, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. And so in the letter to the Hebrews, like, it seems like there were some of these believers that are receiving this letter, that they had made it a habit to just not go to church and not spend time with other believers. And they were doing that, like, there was a fair amount of persecution going on, it seems like. So that probably played a factor in it. But it's also quite possible that there were some people who just didn't think it was that important for them to get together with other Christians. And we don't face the kind of overt persecution that our brothers and sisters that this was written to did, but we do have, some of us, the same temptation to fall into the habit of not getting together with other Christians. And now, all of a sudden, like, we've got this pandemic that presents all kinds of challenges, even if we wanted to get together. Like, sometimes it's just tough to figure out how we actually do that. And so, what do we do? Like, what do we do, say, for example, now, when you're dealing with, and you want to be gracious with these things, what do? When you're dealing with people who, like, they have to work on Sundays. You know, they have to work in order to make ends meet. Or with this current situation, what do you do with people who, like, they have underlying health issues, and so they're trying to be wise in terms of, like, how they deal with those things. I'm not even primarily concerned about that and how this text comes to bear on that. Like, what this text is pointing at is people who, like, just for whatever reason, they're like, I'm not going to church. I'm not going this week. Or I'm not spending time with other Christians just because. There's no good reason whatsoever. If we're going to hold on to the faith, again, you don't just drift towards holiness. You don't just drift towards godliness. If you're going to hold on to the faith, we cannot neglect the assembling of ourselves together as is the habit of some. We need to be getting together as Christians. Which means that we're going to have to learn how to do that. How do we do that in a pandemic? How do we do that, for example, when, you know, there's all of these different, you know, it just keeps changing. So everything was shut down for a little bit. Now it's like, okay, you know, you can meet in groups of 10 indoors for, like, personal gatherings and that sort of thing, or groups of up to 25 outdoors. How do we navigate these things as believers? How do we need wisdom to know how, as citizens of heaven, how do we live dealing with COVID-19 in Canada? We're citizens of heaven, but we also have an obligation to those governing authorities over us. And how do we do that? And just for the record, it would be a whole lot simpler of a situation if there was no public health concerns or no public safety issues involved, and it was just the government saying, hey, Christians can't meet publicly to worship. Then it's black and white, it's clear. Like, we must obey God rather than men. But the situation that we're in now, it's a little bit more complicated than that. When it comes to social distancing and wearing masks and how many people can get together at what time and where, like, we have to sort of think through all of those things as believers. What does it look like for us to honor and rightly submit to those in authority over us, our governing authorities that have been put in place by God? Like, it talks about in Romans 13. And what does it look like for us to show love to our neighbors? Say, for example, like, I don't necessarily want to wear a mask, but I'm hanging around people that, you know, they still have concerns about this virus spreading everywhere, and they feel like people should be wearing masks. As Christians and just people trying to be good neighbors, what do we do with stuff like that? Like if you're a person who feels like, all right, church is open now, like, you should be there every week Sunday. And you're in a congregation with people who still feel like, I don't know. I don't feel entirely comfortable doing that. Like, how do we bear with one another? How do we show love to one another in the face of those kinds of things? What happens if in a month or two from now, like, everybody ends up sheltering at home again? Then what? command to not neglect the assembling of ourselves as is the habit of some. How do we continue to build community where people are growing in and becoming more like Christ? Well, I don't know what to say about a couple of months from now. All I can deal with is or what I try to deal with is what we're presently going through. And so for now, my encouragement would be, so long as we're able to meet, if you feel comfortable coming, keep coming. And when you come, make it a point, be intentional about encouraging one another. Not just be like, okay, yes, I get it. We all need to be encouraged. So come, hear the word, sing, and say your hellos and whatever, and then tell everybody how you're doing, but check on each other too. Check on somebody else. Make it a point to do that intentionally. If you are a person who's okay and comfortable coming to church, don't forget about the people who aren't. Don't forget about those who have underlying health issues or for whatever reason they're not entirely comfortable with coming. Check on them. See how they're doing. There might be some people who aren't comfortable. I'm not trying to be around all of these people, but they might be up for say, if you want to come visit them, and you can do it safely. They sit on the porch, they wear their mask, you sit in the car in the driveway, you wear your mask, talk, and pray for one another. Your neighbors might think you're crazy, or it might turn into an opportunity for the gospel. My point is simply that, we're gonna have to be creative in terms of figuring out ways to obey this exhortation here. For now, you can meet with up to 25 people, social distancing and all that kind of stuff outdoors. Pretty soon, it's gonna be too cold to do that sort of thing, maybe there's a handful of other brothers and sisters that you can get together with and be intentional about encouraging and praying with. We need to be encouraged and we need to be creative and find ways to do that. Join us, if you can, join us in a lot of the stuff that we're doing or anything that we're doing online. Discussion groups, prayer meetings, Sunday school, junior church for the kids. It's not a replacement for actually getting together, but it's a way for us to stay connected. And that's what's important. See, because COVID-19 or not, we need to be together. We need to maintain this connection. We cannot neglect to find ways to build community, or at the very least to stay connected, even if we have to do that at a distance. And this is a priority for us. Notice the language that the writer uses in verse 25. This is urgent. It says, don't neglect the assembling of yourselves together as is the habit of some, but encourage one another, and all the more, not just in light of, for us, not just in light of COVID-19 and all the stuff that's going on, but all the more in light of this day that's coming, as you see the day approaching. That's what it says. It's funny, I don't know if it's funny, but it's interesting to me that, and I've talked to a lot of people over the course of this thing who will tell me how, at different points, they just completely lost track of what day it is. So if you're used to, you have a normal sort of rhythm and routine of what you do for work or school or getting your kids here and there, now all of a sudden, you're at home every single day. It's I don't even know what day it is. All of the days start to look the same. Maybe you can relate to that. But there's one day, brothers and sisters, that we dare not lose track of, that we dare not lose sight of. It's this day when Jesus will come again to gather his people to himself. We need to keep our eyes focused and fixed on that day. That's why it's so important for us to stay connected and where we can to remain in community and actually meeting together with one another. Because Jesus is coming to gather his people. And that's going to be a glorious day. But not for everybody. We're told that this same Jesus who will come again to gather his people In 2 Thessalonians 1, verse 8, it says, he will inflict vengeance on those who do not obey the gospel, on those who do not know God. And so on that day, like if you have not repented of your sin and placed your faith in Jesus, judgment is coming for you. But for now, like Jesus offers forgiveness. Jesus offers salvation. You see, on our own, like none of us can come before God. None of us can approach the God who made us because he's holy. And we're not. We're sinners. And in all of our sin and all of our imperfection, we cannot come near to God. But I talked about in the beginning of this text, like because of Jesus, who he is and what he's done, as believers, we can come boldly. We have access to God. The same thing is true of anybody who repents and believes in him. Like you can have your sins forgiven and you can have access to God. You can come boldly to God in prayer and praise. And you can be counted among that group of people that Jesus will gather to himself on that day. And so, brothers and sisters, for us, like as we await that day, as we long for that day when Jesus will come again, in the meantime, like we have to find ways to stay connected. We have to find ways to encourage one another in the faith and to encourage one another to keep looking to Jesus. We have to find ways to stay connected, to stay in community with one another, help each other grow and become more like our great God and our great King, the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your word, and thank you for its encouraging power. And we pray, Father, that we would not only be encouraged by your word, but that we would be transformed by it as well. So help us, Lord, to live in obedience to what you've required. We know that on our own we cannot do these things. And yet we're also confident that you give much needed grace and strength for your commands. And so help us to find practical ways to stay connected with one another, even in the midst of this pandemic, to maintain community where we are growing and encouraging one another towards the Lord Jesus Christ. And even in all of that, Lord, as we're growing and thriving spiritually, Lord, we don't want to neglect to look outside of ourselves as a community and think about the many around us who do not know you. And so even as we hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, that as we looking for opportunities where we can to make known the confession of our hope to others. We pray that you would save many people through this whole ordeal and use us towards that end, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, let's stand. We're going to sing.